Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Love-Centered Parenting, The No-Fail Guide to Launching Your Kids by Crystal Paine. Narrated by Crystal Paine. Introduction. I never, ever expected I would write a book on parenting. But the reality is that I never could have imagined how much my life and perspective would change in the last 4 years. 4 years ago, I was kind of coasting along as a mom. We had made it past the diapers and sippy cup stage. Everyone was potty trained, praise Jesus. Everyone could buckle and unbuckle themselves when we got in and out of the car, hallelujah. And everyone could make their own breakfast and lunches. Can I get an amen? I finally felt like life was running fairly smoothly, and I had relearned how to sleep through the night again. After 7 years of either being pregnant or nursing or both, I had forgotten what getting 6 hours of sleep all in one fell swoop even felt like. My kids seemed happy. Life felt pretty calm and organized. I was finding my groove, or so I thought. And then, in one day's time, the facade came crashing down, and I had to face the reality that I had been royally missing the mark in my mothering. I had to go back to square one as a mom. I was confronted with the harsh reality that the way I was parenting was not about my kids' hearts, but about my own reputation. As a result, I was wounding my children and setting them up for failure. The events of that day blindsided me, as I'll tell you about in chapter one, but they also showed me that I had to relearn how to parent. This journey has been excruciatingly painful and also deeply healing. It has brought me to my knees before the Lord as never before. It has stripped me of all vestiges of pride. It has changed me to my core. It has transformed the way I walk with, love on, and parent my kids. And it has given me a depth of joy, openness, and relationship with my kids that I never dreamed was possible. This newfound freedom gave me the courage to share snippets of my parenting struggles and failures online. I was scared because I knew I ran the risk of judgment and losing followers. I've written about saving money for years on my blog, moneysavingmom.com. Helping people find creative ways to cut cost, maximize the mileage of their money, and increase their income is my jam. It's what I do. It's comfortable and safe for me. Over the years, I've gotten used to people disagreeing with my take on credit cards or my stance on why I think everyone should consider using coupons. I'm even okay when people dislike my writing style or say that my blog is just not for them. But the thought of having people loudly criticize my parenting choices, that made me sick to my stomach. However, in much the same way I felt compelled to share my money-saving methods for those who were desperately desiring to get in a better financial place, I couldn't help but also share what I was relearning as a mom and the resulting peace and joy I felt. So I timidly opened my virtual door and began letting you into my house, my family, and my life. You walked in. I saw what happened when I shared my struggles as a parent. You walked in. I saw what happened when I told you how much Jesus has changed the way my husband and I are raising our kids. You walked in. You showed up. You sat down at my kitchen table. You said you needed to know you weren't alone. You started pouring out your own struggles and failures and stresses. You told me how tired you were of trying so hard. You confessed your anxiety over feeling that you were failing as a parent and didn't know what to do. You confided your hopes and dreams for your kids. You bared your soul and shared your fear that you were messing it all up and doing it all wrong. And so, I wrote this book for you. Coming up, you won't find a 10-step plan to raise obedient children or 3 strategies for effective discipline. What you will find are honest confessions and tried and true tactics I've learned for loving my kids more wholeheartedly. I know parenting is a hot-button topic and everyone has strong opinions. So in the past, I avoided most parenting-related questions by giving a response that went something like, "Ask me someday, 25 years from now, my kids are all grown. I might have some answers then." But when you showed up at my door and at my table, I felt an urgency to write the book now. as I have opened up and given tiny glimpses into what God has been doing in my heart and life and in my approach to parenting, multitudes of moms and dads have asked me to share more. I'm not a parenting expert or a psychologist, nor did I write this book because I've figured out the secret to producing perfectly parented offspring or because I feel like I have all the answers. Newsflash, I don't. I'm an everyday mom who is still very much actively parenting. I gave birth to baby number 4 while writing this book. I am right here in the trenches with you. We have 4 biological kids, ages 16, 13, 11, and 11 months at the time this book is published. I'm also a foster mom, which means we often open our home to kids of various ages for a short stint or a longer period of time, depending on the needs. In the middle of the first month of drafting this manuscript, we opened our home for a week to a 10-year-old girl who needed a place to stay while her foster family was out of town. A few weeks later, we accepted a long-term placement of a preemie baby who was in the neonatal intensive care unit, NICU. More on that second placement in the last 2 chapters. This journey I've been on the past 4 years has changed my life from the inside out. And it's changed our home and our kids, too. I've stopped second-guessing myself so much and started focusing on leaning in and loving. I've quit worrying constantly about my own reputation or what others will think, and am resting and reliant on God's still small voice of truth to give me wisdom for the next step. I've let go of thinking it all depends upon my doing it perfectly. I've realized that I will make mistakes and that it's better to openly acknowledge them to my husband and kids. I'm believing the truth that I am uniquely equipped and chosen by God to be my kids' mom and Jesse's wife, that there is no one on the planet better suited for the task. My shortcomings and struggles will not ruin my kids or my husband, and I can trust God to fill in the gaps I leave. I'm loving my kids and husband from a place of grace and a space of rest instead of a place of guilt and a space of stress. It hurts me to see parents walking around with so much guilt, exhaustion, and feelings of failure and not enoughness. My heart in this book is to give moms and dads everywhere practical encouragement so you too can take steps toward parenting from a place of freedom and rest instead of burden and stress. Throughout this book, you will not only find my story and practical advice I've learned in my own parenting journey, but I also share tools and support to help you along your way. These include scripture memory verses in bold, a manifesto or two, and at the end of each chapter, 2 transforming truths for love-centered parenting. Several other hands-on helps are compiled in the appendix, recommended readings, questions to foster better communication, flare prayers, and more. Are you ready to join me? Before we get started, here are 2 important notes. Number 1, don't freak out over the grammar. Throughout this book, you will notice that when I tell many stories, I use the pronoun they instead of he or she. The last thing I want to do in writing this book is to somehow hurt my kids' future or share stories that might cause others to view them in a negative light. Protecting my children is more important to me than following grammar rules. Each of my kids has graciously agreed to allow me to use their stories in this book because they have seen the difference in a home shaped by love-centered parenting. Number 2, this book was written for parents of younger children. I want to make it clear that I am not writing for parents of teens. Why? Because y'all, I'm over here very much still parenting teens. And while I think many of the principles can apply to teenagers, I can't tell you how to parent teens because I'm still learning. There, I needed to get that off my chest. I didn't want you to think I believe I am qualified to advise you in this area when I haven't even raised a teenager to adulthood. So this book is written for parents or grandparents of younger kids or for those who don't have kids yet. It's the book I wish I had read when my kids were younger. It would have completely changed the way I parented in those younger years. Okay, now that we've gotten all of that out of the way, let's dive into where this book all started. In the emergency room on one of the darkest days of my mothering. 1, when you don't know what to do. My child is suicidal. I could barely whisper the words to the woman at the emergency room desk when she asked why we were there. My husband Jesse stood quietly behind me. We were both at our wits' end. We had wrestled for days between feeling desperately overwhelmed one minute and resolute the next, pledging we would do whatever it took to help our child. In just 4 weeks' time, our neat little life had shattered in pieces. All my parenting ideals were broken, and I was left reeling, scared, and devastated. It all started one morning during drop-off at the little Christian school our kids were attending. The day began in a normal way. The kids were excited. They had spent the morning chattering about their plans for the end of the school year and the field trip they were going on that day. But then our normal day came to a halt when the principal stopped Jesse at drop-off and said he needed to meet with both of us and one of our kids after school. We were caught off guard. Honestly, we had no clue what the meeting was about. Yet it was clear from the little the principal said that things were not okay. All day, we each felt a knot in the pit of our stomach. Our child had done something wrong, and we didn't know what it was. We racked our brains for any possible hint of anything being amiss the day before. Nothing came to mind. We prayed, we tried to pass the time, and we had this ominous feeling that something terrible was about to go down. We were right. In the principal's office, we learned that our child had done something at school that broke the code of conduct and that swift action must be taken. We felt blindsided and in shock as the principal recounted what had happened. But that was only the tip of the iceberg. Over the coming days, what we discovered would break our hearts in a million little pieces. We knew that our child had struggled somewhat. I chalked it up to normal issues relating to friendships, growing up, and learning to get along. We had no clue that our child actually was deeply hurting and was taking out their hurt on others at school. After our child was told they could not come back to the school, we uncovered many things that had happened in the last 9 months. We found out that numerous parents had gone to the principal, telling him about issues between our child and theirs. Our child had been labeled a bully, and parents had been talking amongst themselves about our child's issues. All this happened while we were completely oblivious. We naively assumed everything was going well. I had been on numerous field trips and attended weekly school functions with these parents. I had no idea that they thought there were serious issues with our child and in our home. I was at a loss as to how to help my child. As this all unfolded, our child began spiraling out of control. The simmering hatred and anger that had bottled up for months was spewing freely from their lips, and it terrified me. Their anger at the world around them morphed into them saying things like, "I should have never been born," or "this world would be better off without me." They became a shell of themselves, and I felt powerless to do anything about it. At the same time, I had my own heart and hurts to try to sort out. On the one hand, I was angry and wounded that none of these parents had come to us to talk about any issues. I was also upset and shocked, honestly, when I discovered that very negative things had been written about our child and posted online by parents without any of them coming to me ahead of time to discuss what had happened. I also felt stabbed in the back by parents with whom I thought I had a relationship. It hurt my heart to know they had been talking about me to others. And it cut deeply to have them now criticizing my parenting to my face. One particularly low point occurred when I was meeting with another parent about my child and this whole situation. The other parent said something to the effect of, "I had thought your family was a Christian family with good morals. Clearly, some things are going on in your home that you aren't aware of for your child to be acting like this." There was also a lot of shame bubbling up for me. I remember being sick to my stomach and feeling as though I was carrying around this crushing weight for days. How had I been blind to the fact that my child was struggling so much? And why did it seem everyone else's family was thriving while ours was falling apart? I also experienced intense feelings of failure and guilt, especially when one parent looked me in the eye and said, "Our child never had any issues until they met your child." While I look back and realize that some of the accusations made toward us and our child during this time were unfounded and unkind, I also see how God used this as a huge wake-up call in my life. Something did need to change, but what? And how had it come to this? Hadn't we done everything, quote, right, just as our parents had with us? My husband and I come from very conservative, God-fearing families. We both were homeschooled and raised in the church. From an early age, our parents instilled God's word in us. We read the Bible as a family almost every day. We prayed together daily, usually multiple times per day. We spent hours of our homeschool year studying scripture. We memorized chapters and whole books of the Bible. We worked through a homeschool curriculum that was based on the Bible. And we were each encouraged to start our day with a personal quiet time reading God's word. We carried on this legacy and taught our kids about Jesus from birth. Actually, before birth. We were the overly ambitious parents who started praying and reading the Bible to our children in the womb. In addition, we planned to protect our kids from worldly influences by homeschooling them through high school with the most Christ-centered curriculum we could find. Oh, and just to make sure we got a head start on this, we went to a homeschool conference when I was only a few months pregnant with our first child. Yes, you heard that right. We could have won the award for homeschool parents of the youngest child in attendance, considering our student was still in utero. Our vision for our family included having 12 kids, homeschooling them all, and being the poster family for godly parenting. I'm not exaggerating even a little bit here. We had lists of goals and dreams. We were highly motivated, and we thought we pretty much had all the answers. I was so sure of my knowledge and wisdom that I wrote a pretty widely read blog called Biblical Womanhood. I taught women in great detail what you should and should not do if you are going to be a biblical woman. Did I mention that I was 23 years old, had only been married for 2 years, and had only one small child when I started this blog? Yep, I was so experienced that I needed to share my wisdom with the world. Insert major eye roll here. As you can probably guess, our life didn't quite pan out in the neatly packaged way we had planned. Yes, Jesse went to law school and we stayed out of debt, one of our first big goals. We had our first child, second goal. And he got the job he really, really wanted, third goal. And I got pregnant with our second child. Woohoo, 12 kids, here we come. But then things started unraveling when Jesse lost his job unexpectedly, soon after he was licensed as an attorney. Around this time, my health also took a downward turn and I was hospitalized for 5 days. They ran every test under the sun, or so it seemed, to try to figure out what was wrong. The doctors finally determined that my symptoms were the result of pregnancy-induced anemia and not something serious like leukemia, as they initially thought. After our second baby was born, things went from bad to worse. Jesse couldn't find any work at all for 3 months. My health was still precarious, and our little church, which had been such a strong support to us over the last year, folded. We lost the one solid place of community we'd had since moving away from our family a few years before. Our bank account was almost empty. We didn't have any steady income. We had a toddler and a newborn. And did I mention I was experiencing postpartum depression? We felt so alone, helpless, and scared. In the middle of all this, I began to question some of my staunchly held beliefs and convictions. I remember feeling so confused and discouraged. Why was God not giving Jesse a job? What were we going to do when the money ran out? Why was God not answering my prayers? I took out the brunt of my fear and anxiety on Jesse. I yelled at him pretty much every day. I was frustrated he couldn't get a job, stressed about how we were going to pay our rent and buy groceries, and so, so tired from caring for a newborn and toddler. I was also trying to keep up the facade of having it all together for all the people reading my blog on how to be a biblical woman. Yep, I was still faithfully blogging there and pretending life was going along just fine. Looking back, I see this season as a crucial turning point in my life. In the midst of the hopelessness, daily fear, and my terrible attitude, God was stripping away my pride, self-sufficiency, and legalistic view of the world. When we got married, I remember thinking, how on earth could anyone ever get a divorce? And yet, on many of my worst days during this period, I didn't just yell at Jesse. I actually threatened to take the girls and leave him. In hindsight, I realize how ridiculous this seems. When I needed him most, I was shoving him away and selfishly focusing on my own fears and worries. When he needed comfort and encouragement from me, I was offering the very opposite. It humbles me to reflect on this time in our life and see how rocky and rough things were. It also moves me to have so much more compassion for others when they are going through hard times. I can no longer condemn or criticize another couple for having marriage struggles because I have been there myself. Walking through this dark season in our marriage forced me to take a good, hard look at everything I believed. All my life, I had somewhat naively held to the conviction that if you honor God and make good choices, you will live a life of blessing. But here we were, having honored God and made good choices, and we were falling apart. Where had we gone wrong? Why was this happening to us? Slowly, ever so slowly, God began to reveal to me that I had put my faith and security where they should not be, in things other than Him. A job, a strong marriage, biblical choices, a good church, and like-minded community. My hope had been in earthly, temporal things that couldn't truly provide lasting hope. A job couldn't save me. A strong marriage couldn't save me. A good church couldn't save me. Even firmly adhering to biblical, quote, rules couldn't save me. Only Jesus could save me. I felt as if everything I had put my trust in was crumbling, and I had nowhere to turn but Jesus. I was so alone and scared. For days, I walked around in a daze. I felt as though the foundation I had stood on for so long had been ripped right out from underneath me. I was re-examining everything I had ever believed to be true. I had nowhere to turn but to Jesus. And as I cried out to Him in desperation to provide for our practical needs, He did so much more than that. In that place of feeling as though everything I had put my trust in was crumbling, God opened up my eyes to see how I had trusted in my good decisions instead of in God Himself. My Christianity had been about doing everything right and following the rules instead of about having a relationship with Jesus. As my loving and good Father and the ultimate love-centered Father, He began transforming my heart to show me that I didn't need to rely upon my good works, my good choices, or a good life for my security. He was enough. He loves me, and I could rest in that. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. It would take years to undo and untether myself from my false beliefs that I needed to do more, be more, and strive harder in order to earn acceptance and love from the Lord. But little bit by little bit, I begin to anchor myself to the belief that I was worthy of love, not because of who I was or wasn't, but because of who God is and who I am in Christ. 9 years after that difficult year in our early marriage, our life looked very different than I ever expected it would. Instead of having a gaggle of kids, we had only three and hadn't been able to conceive again despite years of trying. Instead of homeschooling all the way through high school, we felt God leading us to enroll our kids in a small private Christian school. Instead of being a full-time stay-at-home mom and running biblical womanhood on the side, I had long ago shut down that blog, no longer espousing most of the convictions and beliefs I had so strongly touted there, and was now the family's full-time breadwinner running moneysavingmom.com. True, my life hadn't panned out as I'd envisioned, but I was so fulfilled and felt we were truly seeking the Lord, honoring Him with our lives, and making wise decisions. So how were we back in a place where everything was falling apart? Hadn't we sought the Lord at length about putting our kids in that tiny school instead of homeschooling? Weren't we trying to teach them about and point them to the Lord? It felt like deja vu, and I woke up every day with that familiar feeling of darkness, dread, and discouragement in the pit of my stomach again. I thought we had already been through this and learned what we were supposed to learn during that terribly rocky year of our marriage. Why was this happening again, but this time with one of our kids? Were we just truly terrible parents? Had we completely missed the mark? We didn't know what to do. A number of people suggested finding a counselor, and we decided to start there. Unfortunately, every counselor's office we called was either not accepting new clients or would not take our child. I remember calling one office that had been highly recommended to us, and after being asked several questions, I was told, "I'm sorry, we can't help you. It sounds like you need to hang up and go to the ER since your child is suicidal. We don't take kids who are struggling with those kinds of things." It was so frustrating. How are we supposed to get help for our child when even counselors wouldn't accept us? Desperate and scared, we did as they told us. We packed up and went to the ER. There, after they asked us and our child some questions, they whisked us into a room and made our child take all their clothes off and hand them over, including their shoes. We also had to have someone from the hospital in the room to monitor our child and us at all times. While I understand that this was protocol, and I know the staff were just doing their best, it felt so painful and demoralizing as a parent. As we all sat there waiting for hours, I descended to the lowest point I'd ever reached in my parenting. But it was there, in the pit of despair, that something beautiful happened. God's love surrounded me and held me up. It was that same feeling I'd had 9 years earlier when I realized that so much of my life felt like it was crumbling around me, and yet God was there with me, and He was enough. In that bleak hospital room, I felt His presence and knew that He was holding me and whispering, "I love you. I see you. I've not forgotten you, and I'm with you." I sensed an overwhelming peace that He would carry me through. Little did I know how much I'd need that peace for the next year of intense counseling sessions, doctor's visits, receiving an official diagnosis with multiple letters and labels for our child, the hard road of figuring out the right medication and therapy, more doctor's visits, tests, and so many, many tears and prayers. But we survived. True, we have some battle scars from that year, and things will never be the same again. I'm okay with that. And I'm here to tell you that God was with me through it all, and He has brought so much beauty from what felt like devastation. In fact, that heart-wrenching day in the principal's office started us on a journey to completely transform the way we approach parenting. 4 years later, I'm a radically different mom, and I have a totally different and much better relationship with my kids. That's why I wrote this book. I know that so many of you need a new way when it feels like there's no way. Here's what I came to learn and the truth that changed everything. I realized that most of my parenting had been about me. I was parenting for my own approval and reputation, instead of for my relationship with my kids and for their well-being. I cared more about what others thought than I did about my kids' hearts. I worried more about producing kids who made good decisions than about kids who knew they were wholeheartedly loved. I parented from a place of stress and fear instead of from a place of rest and peace. I thought it was my job to bubble wrap and protect my kids from struggle and hurt. I was trying to be their savior and Holy Spirit instead of their nurturing, love-centered parent who pointed them to their savior and gently led them to listen well to the voice of the Holy Spirit. God allowed me to hit rock bottom so that He could help me relearn how to parent. But first, I'd need to let Him reparent me. I couldn't be a love-centered parent until I allowed myself to be parented by a love-centered Father God. This book chronicles my journey. It's my story of letting go of control and manipulation and parenting for my reputation and relearning to parent from a place of love and grace. I don't know where you're at in your parenting journey right now, but the fact that you're listening to this audiobook tells me your heart longs to deepen your relationship with your child. Maybe you can relate to some of what I've shared. Perhaps you have a child who is really struggling right now and you feel at your wit's end too. Or maybe you're listening to this audiobook hoping you can prevent or protect your child from struggling. Spoiler alert, as you'll hear coming up, I think we do our kids more harm than good when we try to shelter them from experiencing anything hard in life. But I do think there are some amazing ways we can prepare them to better navigate and walk with them through tough situations. More on that later. You may have bought this book or checked it out from the library because you are curious about love-centered parenting and whether it works in the real world. In this book, I'm going to share the hard-won lessons, major changes, and entirely different approach to parenting I took as a result of that shocking visit to the principal's office. It hasn't been an easy road, but it has changed our entire family.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.